Hey, good morning, everybody. We've got a lot of tracks to cover today. Really nervous. I've preached a thousand sermons, and God has given me something I've never been able to preach and put in words before. He's been showing me this for over the past 2 or 3 years, and it has brought me a lot of joy. It really has. And so I want to share this with you today. I'm really nervous about it. Not ever been able to articulate this. And so we're just going to ask the Lord to speak. Father, we ask that you be here. Holy Spirit, we invite you into this place. We pray that you will be in our hearts and speak to us. And God, you're just so good. You're such a good Father. And I pray that you would just give us an understanding today. Just bring to our memories whatever we need. To be able to understand the word that you have for us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to do something real quick. You guys know that we started in August. And I say this all the time. If you cannot minister to children well, don't start a church. And that's one of our big criteria. And so I bet this time last year I sat down at Shooters with a young lady and her wife and said...
Young lady and her
husband, and said, this is awkward. I said, I need help. I need a lot of help. And they said, we would love to help. And I said, you don't know what you're saying yes to. And they said, no, we'll do it. And so I don't know if they regret it today or not, but Misty, would you come up here quickly? Misty has taken over everything that goes on with our kids. I think they do an incredible job back there. And that's all because of the work of this lady right here. And despite my nagging, she has made a life decision without my permission. Her and her husband are moving. And so it's a great move for their family. And I think it's a wonderful idea. It's just too far to commute. So we hate that. We hate that we're losing her. But she's done a fantastic job. And Misty, God used you to plant a church. So well done. I just want to honor her this morning. So everything that your kids have learned, she set that up. And we have a ton of volunteers, and I honor you all. You're doing such a fantastic job. But if you volunteer, you know that this is the one who showed you what you were doing and how to do it and gave you the material and all the training that you needed to do that. So Misty, thank you so much. God has used you beyond what you know in your time in Ranger. So thank you.
Robbie's planted here. He's very permitted, so he'll be here.
Of course you'll be visiting, because I'm here. I mean, because the church is here. So,
3 years of getting off,
yeah. Okay, well, we love you, and thank you so much for all your service. I know that one day she will hear, well done, good and faithful servant. And we're just honored to have been able to be a part of that. So, don't worry. Kids, everything is going as is. She has gotten things running so smoothly that we can just pick up with very little transition. So that's how you know you've done a good job. When things can run without you, you know you've done a great job. Okay, so let's get started today. I'm going to talk to you over the next 3 weeks. We're going to be talking about something, and I want you to understand that. You know, you guys hear this all the time. Don't worry, it's not personal. It's not personal. It's not personal. And that's a bunch of baloney. It is personal. Because I take it personally. Right? Well, what are you talking about, Pastor? Well, I'm talking about a lot of things, but I want you to understand that there are some things that are very personal to us. And as much as the world tries to say that it's not personal, it is. And things that are personal... engage us in every way. So when you are engaged emotionally and intellectually, it's exhausting, right? Have you ever done that? Have you ever been stuck in traffic for a long time? And you're just sitting in your car. You're just putting along, stuck in traffic. And when you get out, you get home, you're exhausted, right? Like you didn't exert yourself physically, but mentally you're just exhausted. Well, that happens spiritually too. And I believe that some of us are living our lives and we're even physically exhausted because something very spiritual is going on within us and it's very personal to us. And if we can get this today, it will be a great source of joy to you. Okay? A Christian life should be a life that is full of joy. But many of us, I mean, man, I believe in Jesus. I believe in God. He created this world. He created me. Yes, He's for me. Do you have joy? Absolutely not. And there's a disconnect there. And I want to speak into that today, and I've mentioned some of this in passing. I want to put it all together today, though. And so for the next 3 weeks, we're going to be talking about things that are very personal to us, and today is heavy on my heart. And I want to pose the question that you've all posed before and ask, where is God in my life? Yeah, he's good. Yeah, I've read the Bible, but where is God in my life? Got your attention? You've asked that, haven't you? We all have. I want to put this just a different way for a minute, and this is where I may lose some of you. Please stay with me. I'm asking you. We try to keep service 1 hour, because I know you can hang with me. So hang with me. This is going to get a little deeper than we normally go. But many of us walk through this earth as spiritual orphans. Okay? And there's a healing that needs to take place for an orphan. There's an adoption that needs to take place as an orphan. If we don't understand that healing process, if we don't understand that adoption process, we will be exhausted in every way, because there's something very personal that is happening to us spiritually. We never have resolve. We never have a solution. Okay, so I want to start right here. If you guys are not great at thumbing through your Bible, we always put all the verses on the screen, so don't be afraid. The verses are always going to be there. This is one of the most important things that we have, and we have these back there by the donuts. If you guys don't have a copy, we have a copy. It's a version that's really easy to read, and we would love for you to take a copy of this. It's not a burden for us. It is our honor to give you one, because if you're not reading the Bible, I'm telling you, you're missing it. This is great. This is a pep rally for what happened during the week while you were reading this and engaging God's people. So we'd love for you to take it. If you're not familiar with it, it's broken up into two sections. There's the Old Testament, about the first two-thirds, and the Old Testament is God's creation and the record of Him moving and choosing His people and promising that one day a Savior would come for the world. Now, when you get into the last 27 books, the New Testament, that Savior comes into the world. He's the Messiah. He's the Christ. He's the one who makes everything better. His name is Jesus. And it begs the question, okay, Jesus walked. What are you going to do about it? So that's the Old and New Testament. Today we're going to be in the New Testament in Matthew. And I'm going to be going through a lot of this quickly. When you came in, you got a connection card. There's a note section on there. We're going to say some things that you may want to write down. You should have a pen close to you. So please use that note section of your connection card, because I've got to whiz through this. Matthew chapter 4, verse I'm going to start in verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Okay? Jesus is led into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. So we know that two things happen. Jesus in the wilderness and the devil is about to tempt him. Keep your eye peeled for the temptations. Okay? After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Until God has opened my eyes to some of what we're going to talk about today, I thought the first temptation of Jesus was to turn rocks into bread. But it's not. When you read it a little closer, back in verse 3, the tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God." And I believe that that is the first temptation that Satan will hit all of you with. See, because Jesus was fully God, but he was fully man. So he came into the world, and he was without sin, so he could be a perfect sacrifice. But he had to figure everything out. Okay? Understand that he dies at 33, doesn't start his ministry until age of 30. So we see very little of his life. We get a snippet of his birth and him at 12 years old. And we know at 12 he's already starting to figure things out. He's beginning to study, figuring out that he is the Son of God. But as he is figuring that out, Satan wants to throw a wrench in that. And he says, "If you are the Son of God, then do this. if you're really the Son of God, then do this. And Satan is throwing the same thing in your life. It is the first temptation. It is the biggest temptation. Satan will always throw it at you if you are a child of God. And so you will mess up in your life. I promise you, you will sin. When you walk through this door, sometimes when you come to first church for the first time in a long time, it's really intimidating because you're like, man, people out there, they might ask me a question. I don't know much. I haven't been in church in a long time. And these people are all good and I'm bad. Welcome to the WoodBridge Church. We all bad, okay? You should hear some of the stories. Yeah, and I'm talking about the pastor's stories, okay? There's no such thing. We've all been bad. We've messed up. I promise you that we've all messed up. And I promise you that you will mess up again, okay? And when you do, Satan will be right there. You can't be a Christian. You can't be a child of God. You can't lead others to Jesus. You can't read your Bible. Because look at what you've done. You've messed up. If you're a child of God, then don't sin anymore. If you're a child of God, then why would you have done that, right? We have that, don't we? See, Jesus did the same thing, but let's see how he dealt with that, okay? Go to Mark chapter 1. Jesus knew that he was a child of God. In Mark chapter 1, we get a snippet of that, verse 9. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. I'm sorry. Just as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from him, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." Now this will preach, it's not for today, but when that dove came on him, it stayed. It didn't go away. When you are a Christian, that dove, that spirit of peace, when it comes, it stays. It doesn't go away. We just have to accept it and live by it, walk by it. That'll preach some other day. But Jesus comes, right, and he gets confirmation. Satan says, if you're the Son of God, and Jesus goes up, John is baptizing, and Jesus walks up, and boom, you have confirmation. See, understand that in the Bible, there is no book of Johnny. There is no book of Jared. And so when I'm looking for things in my life, I begin to just pray over my life, and I begin to read the Word, and God, what do you have for my life? And I pray, God, I need these things to happen, and I look for confirmation in my life. And that's how I know that I'm a child of God. When God begins to speak to me and God begins to use to me, it is confirmation I am a child of God. And the dove has rested on this pastor, and he's stayed. Have I sinned? Absolutely. Lane, be quiet. Kidding. I was afraid she was going to chime in. Yes, I've sinned. Before she has to say anything, I will admit, okay? But the dove has stayed. The spirit of peace has stayed. But the problem is, why am I not walking like that? Why don't I walk like I have joy? And you've done that. Man, you say, you know what? Yeah, the fathers came, and yeah, I had this experience, and there was some confirmation. I know that God is with me, but... Okay, we're going to get there. Keep watching Jesus' life. John chapter 5, verse 19. Jesus gave them this answer. He's talking to his disciples. "Very truly, I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can do only what he sees his Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son does also." And you will see that. Your children will do what you do. They will be interested in what you are interested in. I was talking to a man the other day, and this was before the Cowboys crashed and burned, and he's wearing Cowboys garb and all this stuff. And he said, "Man, I've been a fan for life. My dad used to make me say," he said, "nothing happened when a Cowboys game was on. And I just carry that to this day." And his dad did it, so he does it. My dad couldn't have cared less if the Cowboys were playing or not. I don't watch a lot of football either. We tend to do what our fathers do. But if you don't know your father, if it's in question, who is my father? Then we begin to live as spiritual orphans. We don't know what to do. We don't know who to follow. We don't know who to mimic. But God says you are a child of God. And we live the way that Jesus lived. We're supposed to live the way Jesus lived, and we're trying, right? But he said, "I do nothing on my own. I do only what I see the Father doing." Okay? So I want to tell you today that you, if you are a believer in Christ, then that makes you a Christian, and you are a child of God. If you are a child of God, you have a good father who loves you, will not leave you, and you need to mimic what he did. He will give you confirmation that you are his child, and you can tell Satan, Get away, Satan. I'm a child of God. Sounds simple. Sounds simple, but somewhere we stumbled in there, right? God is a good father. Survey after survey shows that people view God the way they view their own father. That's why we preach about parenting in here, because when we really, really, really screw up parenting, then somebody has this view of, oh man, God's out to get me. When we have no grace and no love and only sternness, we say, oh man, God is pointing his finger. And when we have no sternness and only grace and love, we say, oh, I can live however I want and God doesn't care because he loves me, right? And so we get this bad view of who the Father is, but understand that he is who he is despite who your father was. It is our job to do the best presentation of being a father that we can do, but ultimately, he is a father who loves us perfectly. And sometimes we don't understand God because we don't understand perfect love. And we're walking even though we are Christians, and even though the Spirit resides within us, we still walk spiritually as an orphan. Okay? So the second thing that I want you to see, I wanted us to first see how Jesus handled this, but secondly, I want you to see that we are sons and daughters of God. One of the coolest chapters in the Bible that you may have never read is John chapter 17. And in there, Jesus is praying. This is right before he dies. And as he's praying, in part of this, you know, he prays for himself, he prays for his disciples, and then he begins to pray for those that his disciples would reach. So in John chapter 17, in the latter part of that, you can read the prayer that Jesus prays over you. Super. The first time I read this, nobody had ever taught me that, and I'm like, praying for me. It's incredible. Look what he says in John chapter 17, verse 22 and 23. I have given them the glory that you gave me. This is Jesus speaking to his Father, that they may be one as we are one. I and them and you and me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. And love them even as you have loved me. This is the Son of God. This is God himself coming down as a man. He is the Son of God, okay? Because he was literally a son born from a woman. That's why we call him the Son. And Jesus, praying to the Father, says, I want them to understand that you love them the way that you have loved me. It is him. It is God. There's no one he loves more than Jesus. And he loves you the way he loves Christ. That's good. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Okay. Jesus loves you, and you are a favorite child. Do you understand? You are the favorite child of God. He loves you the way he loved Jesus. Oh, but I've messed up, but I've done this. And he created you. He knew you were going to mess up. None of this has taken him by surprise. Oh, but God, I got to... I did this, and I'm prone to do this. And he's going, yeah, I've been watching. What if your favorite child, we don't have favorites, right? What if your favorite child messed up? You stop loving him? I'm going to say something really hurtful. If you do, it's not being a very good father or mother. We love our children through things. God in his perfection, he is stern when we mess up, but he loves us through it. You are a favorite child of God. Everybody, you can just kind of mumble or like play me off or whatever. I don't ask you to do this often, but will you just say to yourself right now, I am a favorite child of God.
I am a favorite child of God.
Isn't that awesome? Man, God loves us. Okay. Now here's the other part. I could have taken a survey walking in the door. Does God love you this morning? Absolutely, God loves me this morning. But here's a different question. Does God like you? I mean, we do that. If you've ever been married, you've had that conversation where you don't want to go too far. And you say, I love you right now, but I don't like you. Do you understand that God likes you? When God began to speak this into my spirit, this man came in, he was from Norway, and I've told this story once before, but the Norwegian people are, well, they're not American, but he comes in, you know, and he's a little unusual acting, and I'm like, this guy's kind of, what's going on with this guy? And I just begin to cry, and I'm like, what is happening to me right now? I just felt like the Grinch because I don't do that. I'm leaking, right? And I begin to cry. And I don't know what's happening. He came over to me, began to minister, and he said, Pastor, is God pleased with you? I didn't know the answer. I want to pose the question to everybody today. Is God pleased with you? If you can answer that question, it will be an enormous source of joy because you will have... I'm getting ahead of myself. Stick to the notes. 30 minutes. You have a good, loving Father. He not only loves you, He likes you. But we don't live in it. We walk around like we're orphans. I've written a couple things out. You guys know that God began to put this in my spirit when I was 17, 18 years old, because that's when I kind of began this process of wanting to adopt. And if you know, my wife and I adopted a little boy from Poland. And in our research, we learned a lot of things about orphans. And let me tell you a couple things that orphans commonly do, and you can see if maybe this applies to you, okay? Orphans are wounded and strive to heal those wounds on their own. Orphans live without a home, even if they have a good house. Amen. Orphans try to prove their worth. Amen. Orphans have nowhere to go. Even if they have a place to stay, they have nowhere to go. Orphans do the unexplainable. And they do the most mean and malicious, unexplainable things to the people who love them the most. That's the way we live spiritually, isn't it? We're walking around as orphans, even though we have a good father. You know, when Lainey and I began to go through this, we read some books on adoption. She read some books on adoption and gave me the cliff notes. And we began to explain things, but we heard some stories. And, you know, one lady said, you know, we brought this child home, and they do the strangest things. And they told us the whole time, when you adopt, this is not a Hollywood film. This isn't some great story with an ending where just one day everything is better. This is the rest of your life. And they scare the crap out of you, right? Because they want to know that you're serious. But this lady told us, she said, you know, we brought this kid in and we had this room all up and fixed nice. And I walk in and the kid's peeling wallpaper off the wall. For what reason? To this day, I don't know. I didn't know what to do. Just sit down and start peeling wallpaper off with the kid. They do the most unexplainable things because they're living with an orphan spirit. But what happens is they get adopted. And in time, they realize who their parents are. Do you realize if you go pick up an orphan today... I try not to tell too many personal stories about my son because I don't ever want that to come back to haunt him. But I will tell this. When I picked up my son, Elaine and I went over and we lived in Europe for like 3 weeks and then came back, and I went back over for 2 weeks by myself. And 2 weeks by yourself with a kid who doesn't know you in a foreign land where no one speaks your language, that's 2 full weeks, okay? So on the way home, I couldn't fall asleep, man. I mean, it was this journey to come home. And I have this little boy, and I'm in an airport, and I would like to fall asleep, but I can't. Why? Because any single one of you could have come and taken him by the hand, and he would have been just as happy to go with you as he would have with me. And that's the way we treat the Father. He loves us. And any old stranger will come by, and we're just as tickled to go with them. But now that we've had my son for a couple of years, sometimes we'll drop him off. And the first time, Lane and I dropped him off at the church nursery, and he cried. We're high-fiving each other. We're celebrating. And people are like, this is the craziest parents I've ever met in my life. Because he recognized his parents for the first time. Some of you don't recognize God. And you know, I say, man, hey, have you been in your word? Have you been reading your Bible? No, absolutely not. I haven't done that. I want you to be so in tune with your Father that if you haven't heard from him in a day, you're crying in the nursery because you miss Daddy. But we don't do that. We live as an orphan. So because we don't recognize our Father, we'll go with anybody. Just as happily as we'll go with God. orphan spirit. Is this making sense so far, anybody? Okay, I've been really nervous about this. John chapter 14, verse 18. I want you to understand the fourth thing I want us to really go over is that we have not been abandoned. And this is coming back to that question, where is God in my life? John chapter 14, verse 18, Jesus says, no, I will not abandon you as orphans. I will come to you. Jesus tells his disciples, I'm going to go away, but it's a good thing when I go away because I'm going to send the Comforter to you. And he's talking about the Holy Spirit, but look at the language that he's using, the Comforter. It's somebody to fill the shoes when Papa God is not there. The Comforter is here with us. He is never going to leave you as an orphan. If we live with an orphan spirit, it will be because of our own decisions and choices, not because he has left us. And the pastor is admitting at this point, there are some dry seasons where you go, God, I need a word, anything, let me know, hello. Stay faithful, he will never leave you. The Holy Spirit is here and he is the great Comforter. He will comfort you in your time of need. When you need him, I promise you, if you seek God, if you live according to his will, you will never feel or be alone. He will always come to comfort you because that is what a good father does. He does not abandon you when you mess up. He comforts you. It may be stern. You may have to go through things that you don't like. But you are not alone. In the Greek, if you guys don't know, the New Testament was actually written in Greek. And, you know, in the English language, we only have one word for love, and that is love. But in the Greek language, there are four, arguably more, but there are four words for love. One word is used in, I believe, Romans 12:10. It is a word for love, and it's only used one time in the Bible, but it's important that we understand, and it's called storge. S-T-O-R-G-E is the transliteration of the word, but storge love is a familiar love, and I don't mean like common, I mean like family. Storge love is, well, let me put it this way. When a woman has a baby, and now at the hospital they tell you what, and even the dads, they say, take your shirt off, skin to skin, right? Wow, there's some kind of important connection and bond when you do that. God placed a woman's breast in such a manner that when she feeds a child, she's staring into the eyes of this child, and they're making a connection. This is storge. Okay? When you were little and you couldn't find your parents, you freaked out, right? You didn't care if you couldn't find your uncle or whoever. You're like, where's mom and dad? Because you had storge. And we have lived as orphans for so long that we do not know, we are not familiar with storge love. We're just as happy with anybody as we are with God. There's no family connection to the Father. There's no time span. I've told you guys before, how do children spell love? T-I-M-E, right? And that's how you're going to build love with your Heavenly Father as well. I've been roped. I'm back. That's how you're going to build love with your Heavenly Father as well, is time. And you begin to get familiar with God. And you have that storge love. You have that attachment to God. And then we no longer live as orphans. That's why we're pushing the Bible all the time. People come to me, man, I want to get close to God. I want to do these things. And then they're just surprised when we say, hey, read your Bible and pray. Hey, isn't there some other magic formula? No, man, it's time spent with God. And you begin to build up that familiar time with the Father. But instead, we don't spend time with God, and he becomes the one that we blame for everything wrong. Also common in an orphan spirit. Someone's always to blame, and it might as well be God. But I want you to understand something. When an orphan is adopted, take my son for example. He was adopted at a year and a half. just turned four. He's still a kid. Just because he was adopted doesn't mean that he was taken out of childhood. It means that he was taken through it. It doesn't mean that he no longer has to grow up. It means that he has someone to help him grow up. You were born and maybe you're like, you can relate and you feel this orphan spirit, but understand that God has come in and placed his love on you. You still are going to go through life. Bad things are still going to happen. He didn't take you out of life. He's just going to take you through it. As an adopted daughter, adopted son of God. But we begin to blame God. We've got to switch the way that we view this. And there are some things that I just cannot explain. And we say, how could God do this to us? Think about all the times that you said that. Did God do that? This is not a note, but in Galatians, the Bible says it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. And you may disagree with me on this, but I believe that if we were never allowed to go through anything, if we were never allowed to be exposed to sin or anything other than God, then we couldn't choose God. And without a choice, there is no love, right? Yes, things still happen that are bad. But instead of placing the blame on God, look to your Father to bring you through it. So where is God in my life? He hasn't left. You're just going through life. Bad things happen, and they are a result of choices, probably your choices, maybe someone else's choices, and sometimes we are just straight up a victim. Little girl last week, mother dies in a car wreck. Wasn't that little girl's choice? Pastor, what do you have to say about this? What can I say about that? But God knows it, and I trust God that he will never leave that child as an orphan. He will carry her through. Wouldn't wish the circumstance on anyone, but God will be faithful. Now, if we just use God for our blame game, we have a very improper view of God. Now, this is where the joy part comes in. Because if you will get a proper view of God, you will get a proper view of yourself. I brought this. My wife and I like to play spades. Now, I don't know if any of you play spades or not, but in the game of spades, you know, there's four suits in a deck of cards. There's hearts, diamonds, trumps, spades. Which one do you want? Spades! Spades are the good one to have. And we all know that. But when my daughter, who's one, plays cards with us, this means nothing to her, and she likes to eat it, okay? When you're playing spades and you get this dealt, it's a good thing. It's a good thing because you understand the game of spades. She doesn't understand the game of spades, and so this card tastes just like all the other ones to her. And that's the way we walk through life. You are the favorite child of God. This is you. Here's your little mirror. Can everyone see themselves in it? He values you. You are valuable as the favorite child of God. But if you don't understand the game of spades, you don't know the importance of the ace of spades. If you don't understand who God is, you don't understand who you are. If you don't value God, you don't value you. See, in God's economy, things are different. Because the American dream, we say that you are a result of your choices, right? Doesn't matter where you're born, what you do, you're a result of your choices. In God's economy, he says that your value comes not from what you do, but who you are. Do you get that? Your value comes not from what you have done, but who you are. And I'm going to get into this more in a second, but when I die, leave an inheritance to my children. I may love you very much. You're not getting my inheritance. That will be for my children. But your children will make mistakes, and I'm great. You're not my child! It doesn't matter what you do. It matters who you are. In God's economy, it's all about who you are. When you believe in Christ, and yes, that is a choice, so we can argue here, but when you believe in Christ, you become a child of God, and that is your worth. You've made some mistakes. Does it cancel your worth? You've been in some bad stuff. You're embarrassed about some stories. Still the favorite child of God. Now stop. God's a good father. He will punish you. But you are a child of God. And this is the sixth thing that I want you guys to see is there is inheritance for those who are adopted. Do you know in Jesus' day, you could divorce your parents. You can still do that legally. I knew a guy once who did that and divorced his parents legally. But in his day, even though you could legally divorce your parents, there was a clause, there was an exception. If you were adopted, you could never divorce your parents. You are adopted into the kingdom of God. See, we were all born with a sinful heart, weren't we? Doesn't take long to figure that out. You calling my baby sinful? Yes. Yes, I've spent enough time in that nursery. I'm calling your baby sinful. Okay? Love them. But it doesn't take long to figure out that we have a sinful nature. And when God adopts us and brings us in as a favorite child of God, it is irrevocable. Can't take it away. So, for the adopted child, you get the inheritance. And you don't lose it. Go with me to Galatians chapter 4, verse 7. Galatians 4, 7 says this, "Now you are no longer a slave, but God's own child. And since you are His child, God has made you His heir." You know what an heir is, right? Somebody who receives the inheritance. So, if you are a child of God, yes, you've made mistakes. Yes, you're not perfect. Yes, I feel like I have an orphan spirit. But I want you today to receive the love of God. I want you to be baptized in love. Okay? And understand your worth as the child of God and stop trying to prove yourself to God. How ridiculous would it be if I have four children, J.D., Kate, Bodie, and Tinley. How ridiculous would it be if J.D. or Kate or Bodie or Tinley tried to prove themselves worthy as my child? Would it make them any more or less my child? So you are a child of God and you have this question to answer today. Is my Father pleased with me? Not as God my Father. Now, if you've never received Jesus, you've never believed in Him, that His sacrifice paid for your sins and made you righteous, then you are not a child of God. We love you, and that's not a judgmental thing, but you're not a Christian. We want you to do that here today. But if you are and you say, I have received Jesus, I believe in His payment for my sin, and that makes me righteous, that makes me a child of God, then stop trying to earn it. You've already got it. You're going to wear yourself out and you're only spinning your wheels. Instead of trying to earn God's salvation and work for your position, I'm going to urge you to work from your position. I'm not preaching to you passionately because I'm trying to prove myself to God. I'm preaching to you passionately because I am a son of God. I'm working from my position as a child of God, not for my position as a child of God. You are going to be miserable trying to prove yourself to God. You are going to have a lot of joy answering the question, God likes me. The Father is pleased with me. Really? If you could say that, if you could come up today and say, God likes me. And He's happy with me. Would that change things? I believe that the church needs to bring joy into a community. We have a lot of plans. You guys kind of stay tuned with us in the church, and there will be an opportunity for you to serve in all these things. But in the spring and even before, we have a lot of plans for this community, a lot of things that we want to see done, and you can engage in all of those things, and there's fulfillment out of that, but it'll all just be a task. It'll all just be something else if you're not a child of God and a favored child of God. You'll just be more trying to prove your worth and spinning your wheels. When a church steps into a community, then the community should improve. And when a church steps into the community, the church should have joy. But we don't have joy because we have an orphan spirit. If you have an orphan spirit today, I want to speak this into your life. Ben, you guys go ahead and come up. I'm almost done. If you're in here today and you have an orphan spirit, let me just speak this into your life. You have a father who loves you, a good father, and you are his favorite kid. You don't have to work to earn God's favor, earn God's love anymore. If you're in here today and you say, you know what, I mean, you keep talking about being a child of God, and quite frankly, I don't know if I'm a child of God. Here in just a moment, I'm going to pray, and I want you to pray with me. And after we pray, these guys are going to play, and we're going to do one last song, and then we're going to go. But as they do that, some men are going to come forward, and they have offering baskets. If you're a believer in here today, that is part of how we worship. Don't worry, guys, we're not pushing. We're not going to give anybody the shakedown for their offering, okay? But you can do that here. Also, if you look on our website, you can give online. But as they come, also the appropriate thing to do now is take those connection cards and drop it in there. If you've not filled that out, if we've never gotten that from you, please do that. But if you want to receive Christ, if you'd like to be baptized, join a life group, any of those things, put that on there. Prayer request, put that on there. But right now, I want you guys just to bow with me. I'm going to pray a prayer. And if you've never prayed and said, Jesus, I want you to come into my heart and save me. I want to be a son or daughter of God. And I'm going to pray, and I want, just right there in your seat, I want you to pray with me. Now be bold enough to give us that connection card and let us know that you prayed this with us. But everybody bowed, and I'm going to pray. And if you've never received Jesus as a payment for your sins, would you pray with me right now? You don't have to do it out loud. You can just do it silently there in your seat. But Father, I have sinned, and I am not worthy to be your child. But I believe, Jesus, that you died on the cross to pay for all of my sins and wash them away. I receive your payment for my sin. Come be my Father and heal my orphan spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.